President of the Johnson County Chapter of the United Nations Association, and I am thrilled to see so many of you here tonight to celebrate International Women's Day and to support the work of the United Nations in their refugee work. And to start us off tonight, I invite the Iowa City Mayor, Jim Throgmorton, to come and welcome you.
Thank you, Jean. Can you hear me okay? All right, good deal. So thanks for inviting me to be here with you tonight. It's really a great pleasure to be here, especially in this recently renovated space. I hope you will check it out, the basketball court, downstairs, all the other parts of the recreation center. It's really been well renovated. And before I say anything else, please join me in giving a really big thanks to all the good people who prepared our food for the night. I mean, it's a great food. It's especially pleasing to welcome you on behalf of the people and government of Iowa City. This includes the newest member of our city council and the first Sudanese American woman to be elected to a city council in the United States, Mazahir Harris Thulani. Right here. It's fun being with Mazahir. Both of us trying to learn how to be on the council together along with others. It's a difficult task for anybody who's on that council, so it's really fun to be going through that process. So we're here this evening, the night before the International Women's Day, to celebrate the achievement of women, right? So it's hard to know where to begin. So many women have done so much, including Jean, right there. And as we all know, it feels like there's been a massive cultural shift over the past year, the year of hashtag MeToo and the year of Time's Up and so on. But the specific theme for tonight's event is building a better future for refugee children. As you know, the proceeds from the event will go to help support the school at Kenya's Kakuma refugee camp. So I'm happy to say that some of the refugees from Sudan and Congo have found their new homes in Iowa City, including many friends who are in this room right now. And I'm really pleased about that. And you know, I understand we're going to hear from the panel of five people who have been at the camp. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. And four of them are students at Kirkwood or the University of Iowa, and the fifth is a former teacher at the camp. So, when I think about the achievements of women in relation to building a better future for refugee children, my mind goes to an unexpected place and an unexpected person. The place I'm thinking of is the former part of Germany called East Prussia. The woman I'm thinking of is Hannah Arendt. Some of you will recognize her name, others might not. I want to tell you just a little bit about Hannah Arendt and connect it very quickly to the topic of the evening. So initially, a young Jewish woman growing up in the German East German part of Germany called East Prussia, Hannah Arendt studied philosophy under two famous teachers, Martin Heidegger and Karl Jaspers, in the mid-1920s. She was living in Berlin when Nazis and communists battled in the streets. But she fled Germany in 1933 by crossing the border illegally. That's right, she was an illegal immigrant when she crossed the border. And she was in Paris when the Nazis crushed the French army in 1940. She was transferred to a Vichy camp, but somehow managed to obtain an exit visa. This narrow window of time, it's like just a few days, she got an exit visa and moved to New York City in 1941. and largely as a consequence of those experiences, spent the rest of her life writing intellectually powerful...
Time out. My paper got stuck.
Intellectually powerful and controversial books emphasizing the importance of human beings acting in the public realm, that is, discoursing, persuading, deciding on specific deeds, and then doing in the world, trying to change things for the better. So for me, Hannah's life exemplifies how a female student refugee can help build a better future. So anyhow, enough of me.
Let me conclude by simply saying how much I look forward to hearing the panel's discussion. Great pleasure to be here with you tonight. Thank you.
We are very fortunate to have such a marvelous mayor. He is one of three mayors in Iowa who signed on to the International Covenant of Mayors, which came out of the Paris Summit. And so we're very proud of him for that, and hope that we get more mayors in Iowa to join that group. No community on the planet can do what I'm going to do next, what all of us are going to do next. We're going to honor Maza here for her remarkable accomplishment. Would you just come out? She had the courage to put her name on the ballot. She had the energy and the determination to run a terrific campaign. And she was successful in achieving her goal. Last November, she was elected to the Iowa City City Council. And we are very proud of you and wish you every success in your new position at the City Council.
Thank you.
And if you would hold this 1 minute for me.
I just would like to thank Martin Boyd Jones, the president of the Johnson County Chapter for the United Nations Association. And also, I want to extend a thank you to all the women in the room, like on celebration of the Women's Day. And I guess this is really going to be a group effort when we come together as a woman to make this world full of justice for everyone. And I'm very excited to receive this. It's my honor to receive this award. And thank you so much. I will really promise to work hard to make this community work for everyone. And I will hope to inspire all the refugees and the immigrant women like me who travel half the world to come to the United States. So we can do this. And we got this. Thank you.
Twice as much money to the school in Kenya and so we were delighted with that. They are all listed on your program, and I think their logos are being shown on the screen. So we want to thank them very much for all of their support. The pages stick together. I think it's the weather. Now we have two very important United Nations Association people in the crowd. First, I'm going to introduce John Fraser, who is the state president of the United Nations Association. John. And Andrea Cohen, who is the executive director of the IOAA. We're very fortunate tonight that we have a group of wonderful volunteers from the University of Iowa Human Rights Group. And Rebecca Howard, where are you? Will all of the volunteers who are with Rebecca tonight hold up your hands? The committee that put this event together, I don't want you to clap for all of them, it will go to their heads. I will just introduce them one by one, they will hold up their hands, and then you can applaud at the end. Jim Olson, the chair. Natalia and Bob Burnham, who are managing the silent auction. Natalia managed the food, and Bob the silent auction. Katie Hansen. Elisa Meggett. Jean-Paul Mugamuzi. Where are you? Maria Padron. And Dorothy Paul. And now you can all applaud. The University of Iowa Student Chapter President, Alexa Sandin, is here. Alexa, where are you? Now for the program. We're going to start with the voices, the refugee and immigrant voices are now going to perform for us. And I'd like to, Jean-Paul, I would like you to stand up because Jean-Paul is the director of this group.
Yeah, the word that you're about to say, you have to say thank you to the United Nations Association for some time for the help and everything that we're looking for the refugees who stay in the refugee camp. And this is amazing to see people who are far from miles and miles thinking about the people of far than the people who are just maybe 5 miles from those people. The people staying 5 miles from the refugee camp, they cannot even think about the children of the camp. But people are staying far and far, they're thinking how they can be able to bring those children to education. And this is very inspiring for us. Thank you very much.
others, but it goes to every woman and everybody. It talks about spiritually, about women being the army of God, women being beautiful, but it's mostly about God. It talks about how as women should continue preaching the gospel of God to everybody, not just women, but also youth, pastors, or youth, men, everybody. Thank you.
High Commissioner for Refugees, that is the UN Refugee Agency, to support refugee schools throughout Kenya. Many of our members wanted to do something tangible, something concrete, to respond to the worldwide humanitarian crisis in which there are 65 million forcibly displaced persons, including over 20 million refugees. And so in conversations with the UN Refugee Agency, it was decided that educating refugee children was the best thing that we could do to help not only those children, but in fact their families. On your table there is some information about refugees, and you notice that a great many refugee children are not able to attend school, or they attend schools that are overcrowded and under-resourced. And if those children are vulnerable, they are at risk, they are perhaps in danger of being radicalized, and their families face very dim prospects. And so we believe that helping refugees become educated is a way of securing a better future for them. We're very fortunate in that we actually have here in Eastern Iowa a number of people who lived in the Kakuma camp, and we're going to hear from five of them tonight. And as an introduction to their presentation, we're going to screen a video that was made by a resident of the camp. We have contacts with the filmmaker in the camp, and we're very grateful to our colleague Belton, who helped us make contact with. Let's recognize Belton. Belton is a community service director of the Refugee Immigrant Association, and he's the one who put us in touch with this video maker who made this 5-minute video. This is not a case where somebody from America or the Western world went into the video camera, but this is actually an authentic expression of someone who lives in the camp. And so we'll watch the video, it's 5 minutes long, and then we will hear from our panel.
Ethiopians, Sudanese, Rwandese, Eritreans, Burundis, and compared to previous years. Majority of refugees and locals depend on the small businesses grants we need to come.
My name is Bular, and I lived in Calhoun County for 7 years. I got there in 2005, and I left in 2011. And first I arrived, we got to be in Michigan, and then as they all said, since I was a land of opportunity and great school and everything, so we decided to move to Iowa.
In college, then I went back I was involved in one of the programs which was giving scholarship to those students who were coming very well to school. So we used to say that we came to school and from talent and enjoying about education. And recently, before that, in 2011, there was this program from Gonzaga University and Georgetown University, which were giving distance learning. So there was a program of distance learning that are giving it's a program that they select different students from the camp who do not have the opportunity to continue with the higher education. So we started it was a room with a computer. So the students come there and learn from business and learning from Tosaga and Georgetown University. That's how the system worked.
He said something about that is currently in the refugee camp in Macau. As we all see the video here, as I'm here today, you can see the weather is on the refugee camp. It's hot in the refugee camp. And it's a very hard place for me. But people have to, they don't have a choice. As we're living with a different community, different nationality, people love each other. So it gives each one of us the strength and the courage to continue living in that place. So I would like the refugee camp because we learn a lot. We, some of us who came from our home country without education because of what we learned. But in the refugee camp, we get some educations which we didn't have. That's something that sends a very good place. And it's some place we need to be forget in our lives. That's what I can say about this kind of the refugee camp. Thank you.
So I'd like to
ask
our panelists to say a little bit more about education and schools in the camp. And we'll start with
education is the key to success. And I believe it doesn't matter who you are or where you are or what situation you have, so long as you get that opportunity to go to school or if you're given that chance, you gotta take it. And that's what most of us in the refugee camp did. We saw that opportunity, it was open for us. It doesn't matter how many students or how many people we are in the class. We had to go get it because we know and we believe that we never know where we're going to be or where life is going to take us. So it's whatever we have, that small partial education we get, that we believe was going to help us. And here we go, it's really helping us. So I believe education is part of the thing that is helping a lot of refugees in the Department of Refugee Camp and adults, youth, children, and even anybody that are doing that. And I believe we believe we continue with that chance as long as we get more opportunity or more open doors to get a lot of schools, since we know we live in a lot of cities, a class full of maybe 900 students. So it's kind of hard for someone to focus and to concentrate on what you're doing or what you're planning to do. But I believe if we have more schools and more facilities, it would be great for everyone in the camp to continue with their education.
Yeah, I agree. And what he said earlier about how the students were just going to school just for food, it was so most of us don't have the motivation to go to school because they understand what education is. But if they have like schools that are good and they teach them well and like how to operate well in life, then that would be like a plus for them because you go to school just for food, but then you learn something. And while you're there, you might fall in love with something and it's going to be your passion. So I think if they have more opportunities for this, it would be like a part of it. Because I was do that because my family was able to do that. But most students are not able to do that. I have to go an extra mile just to get the proper education, which most students didn't have. But if we had that proper education in public schools, I wouldn't have to go to private schools just to get that. And I think that's why we should put our money into their futures, because everyone needs proper education.
As the board is saying, education is very important in the own lives. As a child in the refugee camp, I remember going to school, as I say, just for porridge, nothing else. And if I find out that they don't cook porridge that day, that we just change. I remember being in a class of pre-language students, and as a stubborn kid, I never sit in front desk, I always sit in the back. So, like, being in that kind of situation, I found myself at the age of 7, like, I didn't know how to read or write. So imagine me going to school and being at that age, she or he doesn't know how to read or write. It's a very sad thing. So I think we should put more effort into donating, like, more stuff to help our education system and, like, building more schools and employing more people as like teachers so we can have people who give kids a good education.
So thank you. I want to conclude by asking each of you if you could give a message to Americans. What would you say? This is your opportunity.
Sir, you said the other end.
Came to the beginning of life. That's from more than America. There is no any nation bigger than America. The United States of America. I learned from history, the Romans, the Greek, and whatever, but I never understood that history. But now I'm living in the United States. What I was learning from my experience, there are very many people in America, very many, so very big names like Neil Armstrong, the three Armstrong that you know, the President of the Moon, the Armstrong in the jazz, the Armstrong in the seconds, the Mary Jones, name them. There are so many names in America, so many, all over, in history, in science, in music, in religion. So there is not any person in the world who has ever been affected by the American dream. No one. Be it in politics, be it in religion, be it in life, be it. So whatever you can, I think the majority of the aid that you're getting came from the United States. And they came from individuals like you, giving money, DT. And recently, I started to also giving donations. So I joined the Feed the Children, and I take like $20 each month. And it's nothing, you don't realize it. You just go into the bank account, they took out $20. And after all, for 20, they spent $20 just paying for thank you for the loan that we have. But if you give out $20, it makes a difference. Have someone behind the gun, maybe between them for one, sharing a cup of porridge so that they can go to school. So, America is great. And when I came to the United States, I learned something. So, the Americans do not want to be helped, they want to help. So, I learned from the US. I don't want to be helped. I would like to help too. So, you tell someone about all the laws. Going through targets, you go, can I talk to them? Oh, okay. They'll open for themselves. And when you're out, they'll make sure the gate is open so that you can go into. So, being a refugee in the United States and being a recipient of the aid of the United States to the American people, I think that it made me to be a different person. So, I think America is great and people are great and continue to be great. Thank you.
Maybe we'll have a little chance after after we adjourn. But I want to thank our panel for sharing their experience, for being with us, for living in our community and making our communities even better than